Let's start this conversation with what's at the core of this whole information process, the brain, monospiridon. We talk about cognitive biases a lot. How does our brain think for us, if I can put it this way? Correct me if that's a stretch. Good evening. Thank you for having me. I'll try to summarize this whole concept of cognitive biases. You have to know that the brain receives information, a lot of information every second. I'm not talking about information, you know, media from the media or social network. No, I'm talking about information through our senses, visual information, auditive information, and so on. So the brain cannot process all this information. It needs to go through shortcuts. Maybe I should give a definition of cognitive biases, but cognitive biases are mental strategies that influence the way we perceive reality and also our judgment and our choices. So basically, cognitive biases are approximative ways of thinking, which are very useful because very often our brain needs to make decisions very quickly. Just imagine you're in the middle of the night in a dark forest and you hear a strange noise. It's very unlikely you will say, no, I need to look into it, I need to analyze it, I need to know what is going on. Because if you do that, well, maybe you won't be there to tell the tale. So intuitively, your brain will try to make the best decision, but through approximations. There's also the fact that the brain aims at keeping a certain consistency with its surrounding. Because we do not perceive everything at all times, the brain needs to fill the gaps and try to make everything consistent, to have a stable picture of what's around it. To give you an example, for example, this table, I can only the top of it, I don't see legs, but I can imagine that there are legs. Obviously, the top of the table is not floating in the air, even though I can only see it from the top. So we always try to fill in the gaps so that what we see or go through remains consistent with our model of the world. So the brain is not a passive receptacle that receives information, like a camera would, for example. The brain receives information and then interprets them. It creates its own reality. That means that we build our own perception of the world. We build our reality, and we constantly reinterpret it so that it's in line with what we know and what we expect. I hope that was clear. Well, if I come back to your first example, you know, hearing a crack in the middle of the night in a forest, maybe it's better to flee. Does that mean our brain is made for survival rather than for thought? Well, survival is the core engine, you know, that's very Darwinian in a way. Those who have behaved in a way that allowed them to survive will be able to spread their genes. So obviously it is an essential engine to be able to survive. So it's survival over looking for truth. Well, if survival is in competition with truth, then obviously, yes, we're going to go for survival. Pascal Wagner-Aga, you were saying that cognitive biases are not written in stone. We're not born with them. So how do they come about? Well, there are many hypotheses. They're scientific hypotheses. We don't know much about it. But it is possible that some cognitive biases are actually enshrined in our brain, especially when it's related to danger. It wouldn't be absurd to think that the main objective of our brain would be survival and nothing else. It wouldn't be, you know, the string theory. theory or the Higgs boson. It's about survival. So it is possible, it could be possible that we have cognitive biases hardwired in our brain. But then there are other cognitive biases that we learn throughout our childhood or throughout our life. For example, being self-complacent. You know, we tend to think that we're a good person, you know, we're a bit better than average. Statistically, it's not possible, right? If we're all better than average, then the average increases. But that's a very pleasant illusion. But same thing with the risk. We always feel that we are running fewer risks than other people. And that's much less positive, of course, because that leads to putting ourselves in danger. So thinking that we're not as good as other people, that would be quite depressing and mentally difficult. And then also social biases, conformism, thinking what other people think, not questioning things that we have learned, not questioning authority. Those are social biases. And when we talk about cognitive biases, it can be hardwired in the brain, or it can be in our own psychological, cultural, social identity.
You say that there are types of bias that are engraved in our brain, like survival, but there are others that are learned. Is this an active act of learning? Is it voluntary, or does it happen despite us? I think it's something that we learn through socialization. Stereotypes, for example, come from others. We don't know what to think about people we just meet, so we take these from what we've heard from our parents or at school. That's how these biases grow up. You were talking about cognitive biases that are beneficial. This brings me back to what I said during the introduction. When we doubt, when we receive information, even news or current affairs, we have to try to understand it. If we want it to be beneficial, we mustn't challenge this information. Is that right? Maybe later, not straight away. Yes, it's a confirmation bias. We have lots of examples about this in scientific studies. We tend to prefer information that seems true to us. And this is borne out in many areas. It's easier for us to memorize information that is aligned with our beliefs. We will like a scientific study better if the conclusions are in keeping with our beliefs. So confirmation bias, it's a comfort thing. And socially, it's the same thing. We're right and the others are wrong. So if cognitive biases are not naturally implanted in our brain, that means that human beings are not a lost cause in terms of receiving information. We also hear a lot about intuitive thinking, a very rapid decision-making process. It's a heuristic process. You can also train yourself to counter cognitive bias, not have one belief system, but two. I don't know if you've read Daniel Kahneman, who popularized this idea. We have system one, which is the intuitive, effortless thinking system or process, which can be implanted in our brain. And system two is more analytical. It requires more effort. The example is when you have a math problem, you might sweat, have to expend a lot of energy, it tires you out, you're hungry, you can feel the effort. But with system one, you can fight your first intuitions. You can say, no, let's check this information. Let's not go with our first impression. So you can train your brain individually to not give in to these biases. Yes, I question about that. You said train yourself or practice. How would you do that? Because it's not a natural reflex to question your own thinking. Through metacognition, which is understanding our cognitive processes, and that's a good step in the right direction. If you know, for example, that your brain works in a certain way, works in that way, and that it leads to errors, this will help you. You might have sales techniques, or know about sales techniques so that people can't manipulate you and sell you things that you don't want. If you know about these sales techniques, maybe you can avoid being manipulated. At the railway station, for example, and somebody says, hello, young man, how are you? When I hear hello, young man, and he's used the familiar verb form, form of address, I can already tell that this is an attempt to manipulate me. So this makes it easier for me to say, well, I know what these techniques are about. And it might be the same with our brain. Some studies seem to say that knowing about certain biases can help us to avoid them. No, well, I like it whenever somebody calls me young man. So let's go back up the chain or process to technology. I think most of us use information through electronic devices. And Hannes Gressiger. You're going to tell us what we need to be careful about because our brain receives this information before it can do anything about it. I speak French, but I'm a bit too slow.
And I understand you, I think most of it. So I'm an investigative journalist focusing on technology. So I look basically in my work at all these artificially constructed information environments, so that you are, observing when you're using TikTok, Instagram, whatever. And so, and also in my work, I look at the people who are basically building that kind of information infrastructure. So I'm looking at a market mechanisms and companies that are trying to exploit these behaviors and weaknesses. And throughout the last maybe 10 years almost, I've been focusing on disinformation, manipulation during elections, stuff like Cambridge Analytica, and discussions such as this, where we see the real world implications that are being derived by these companies and bad actors using these company infrastructures for a certain good, either for making money or for coming into power. And so I've also seen how these mechanisms are basically ruining and fractally fragmenting the media scape. So as a journalist, I've seen the impact these networks had on the journalistic infrastructure. So what we are doing right now is setting up a new infrastructure, a new form of social network that should not exploit these vulnerabilities we're talking about here.
Can you give us a few examples of these, well, not vulnerabilities, but technologies that private companies use? You say that they're used by bad actors. Tell us about these technologies. And are these bad actors the companies that develop the technology? Are they other actors who use them in one way or another because of technological neutrality?
For example, one thing we're observing within journalism is the rapid spread of misinformation. And so what is being exploited here is something we call the liar's dividend, meaning that no matter whether an actual piece of information is true or not, if it seems to be absolutely newsworthy, then people have a tendency to share it on platforms just because it contradicts what they know about the state of the world, right? And so within Facebook, for example, during the 2021, there was a major leak where it was being exposed how people work within Facebook to go against a certain behavior, such as the spread of misinformation, and how they use, for example, demotions of certain pieces of information as a technique to stop that spread, right? And so these are fairly, these are based on certain assumptions about what the companies want people to see on the platforms, right? And these assumptions are formulated according to what the company wishes to achieve, mainly to make money, right? And so these structures are not controlled for, are not visible to us, and that's the main problem, I think.
On parle ici aussi des biais cognitifs.
We're talking about cognitive bias. We talk a lot about algorithms that study our behavior to sell us other things. Is the use of technology that sends us back an image of ourselves to try to manipulate us, does that reinforce cognitive bias? I don't know who wants to answer that question. Is it back and forth? Is this back and forth a reinforcement mechanism and does cycle?
And I hand it over to Mona. Is we are heading for not one algorithm that feeds us all, but for something that is ultra-personalized. So you will end up in your own version of information environment according to an algorithm that learns about your specific weaknesses. So we have individual traits, right? And the platform learns how to adapt your information to that trait.
Justement, donc ces tendances individuelles vont nous...
Do these individual tendencies reinforce our... I don't know about the latest technological advances, but in general, what we see on social media is that we do tend to receive information which is similar to what we usually look at. And it gives us the impression that everybody agrees with us, because all that we see is that same kind of information. So we're not exposed to contradictory or different information. So it's true that that will reinforce what you said, the confirmation bias. A lot of people share my opinion, we'll think, because everyone seems to think the same thing. So is there a threshold in our entourage when an image or an opinion spreads? Is there a point where we adopt it as well? If everyone around us adopts it, do we then adopt it? Hannes Kreisiger, you were talking about economic issues because obviously selling and making money is at the heart of all this. Or could it also be used for non-economic purposes when we're talking about manipulating information? Do you think that it's a bit of a caricature, but I hope that your response will be less so? Is it these companies who are trying to manipulate us, or is it third parties?
It's actually very hard to judge how manipulative these companies are, because, for example, one of the techniques being used inside Facebook was also to test out whether it would be useful for the platform to insert a contrary opinion into your own conversation, right? And to see how people react to that. And for example, in 2014, there was a major study about emotional contagiousness on platform, on Facebook, sorry. And what they did is they inserted a negative or positive mood into the news feeds of the persons, and then they observed whether the people would be negatively affected and whether that would secondarily negatively affect their friends and followers, right? And it turned out, yes, it did. So all these experiments are constantly going on. So yes, we are being constantly manipulated, but not for any like political purpose. Probably not in the case of TikTok, which is a separate thing because of its Chinese state affiliation. But for the rest, it's like market-based, trying to optimize your time spent on a platform.
Est-ce que c'est pas un biais cognitif que ce que dire que TikTok et les Chinois, eux, ils ont plutôt une...
TikTok and the Chinese, isn't it a bit weird to say that they're not trying to manipulate us? I don't totally agree. I think that if Facebook and Twitter, you heard about the Twitter files recently, where we saw that political actors were playing an important role in regulating and controlling the information flow, including the FBI, that it turns out is affiliated with Twitter or was associated with Twitter. So in this particular initiative, so political figures can also use the platforms to get their messages across and to block other messages.
The Twitter files is actually a great example of how platform logic can be abused, because the way platforms are built is basically in a pyramidal scheme. So there's an ownership, right? And right now at Twitter, it's Elon Musk that decides over what the rules of the game are within Twitter, right? And if that guy has a certain political opinion, then yes, he can or she can implement that opinion on the way the platform is managed, right? And so certain tendencies can become more prominent or less prominent. And so we can have a political exploitation, but that's not the core incentive by which these companies were being started, right? And so I think the Twitter files is also an example of how there's a misunderstanding of platforms as independent media. They are not. They are like private shopping malls. So you cannot expect them to be independent actors. But in that case, I give you, yes, that's a yes, but their incentive was not to be a political party affiliated or something like that. Because they're global in reach, they cannot connect to a political party too much.
Merci beaucoup. Giuliano Da Empoli, vous êtes au bout de la chaîne, si j'ose dire.
Thank you very much, Giuliano Da Empoli, you are...
On l'a vu, donc l'utilisation de tout ce qui vient d'être présenté...
At the end of this food chain, if I can put it this way, what you've shown in your book is that all of this, if we control it, if we know how to use all of that, we can engineer chaos. You talk about engineers of chaos. Who are these people? Well, I'd like to bounce back on what has been said until now. Engineers of chaos are political operators, political entities which are going to try to use this approach, which at the outset was a business approach of platforms, and they twist it in order to be able to use it to their end. Digital platforms are designed to please you, to give you more of what you want. So, in a way, to trap you, to entrap you in your own mental palace, in your own information bubble.
And
the issue is that it's not exactly what is happening. So there are people like Guillaume Chazelot, for example, who did research on this, who used to work for YouTube. Research has proven that every time you do you search for something on YouTube, the platform will give you content which is similar to your previous searches, but with a twist. They will try to sell content that they call attractors, and has been proven that these content tend to generate more interactions. For example, if you look for information on the solar system on YouTube, you will find maybe 8 videos on the solar system and then 2 crazy videos on the Earth is flat and that sort of things. And it has been proven that that sort of content tends to generate engagement. And that's the only thing that platform owners are interested in, because what they want is generate engagement, attention, reactions. They want you to spend more time on their media.
Justement, la tendance est d'aller vers des contenus qui
and the trend
des attracteurs et qui
is to push attracting
et donc,
content, content that will generate more engagement
les ingénieurs du chaos
and
sont
potentially content that can fuel the fire.
Adopter la même logique. Et donc,
engineers of chaos are simply political operators which are going to adopt that same logic. The way they craft their political narrative, they will try to meet that sort of need, and they will build their political program in a way that gives less weight to more traditional aspects, of, for example, the consistency of the program, not contradicting yourself one day to the next, and they will put more focus on things that will have the potential to fuel the fire. And that will cascade down the internet in many different ways. So it sounds a bit odd said like that, but in practice it can bring about the very different result. It can be, for example, what Donald Trump used to do when he was in power, what he did before the COVID-19 pandemic. For example, once he went to Colorado and he gives a public conference, a political meeting, and he says that he's building a wall, wonderful wall in Colorado to protect the U.S. from Mexican from immigration from Mexico. But the issue is that there's no direct border between Colorado and Mexico. You know, there's New Mexico in between.
So that,
you know, in these strategies, the traditional media, they are fundamental, they play a crucial role because they fall in all the traps that are set for them, all of them. They have not understood this new way of communicating, and very often they even amplify these new political communication strategies. So what happens when Donald Trump goes to Colorado and claims that he's building that wall? And the whole thing explodes, the whole system talks about it like it happened in the past, and dozens of times later everybody is saying that the president of the U.S. doesn't even know that there's no border between Colorado and Mexico. It's unbelievable, it's outrageous, and so on. All right, that's a legitimate reaction. It would have worked in the previous media system, but it does not anymore. Because what is happening when Donald Trump goes to Colorado and claims that he's building a wall on the border with Mexico? The first thing is that everybody talks about it. Everybody is revolted. So what is happening is that he's putting his topic back at the core of the political agenda. Everybody's talking about the wall. The media is talking about the wall. Even if it's just to say that he's so stupid he doesn't even know where the border is. That's the first thing. Then he strengthen the framework of his success, which is based on cognitive biases, which is, I'm against the elite. Everybody is shocked by how ignorant he is and how much nonsense he talks. Very well. It confirms to his base the fact that he is struggling against the elite, the establishment, mass media, journalists, academics, traditional politicians, and so on. Thirdly,
and
that is a very bold move. Very often, in the craziest fake news that we can encounter, there is always this element which is, with my own willpower, I will challenge the narrative that not everything is possible. So I will challenge that narrative by saying that I will build a wall on a border that does not even exist. You know, it sounds crazy, but it's different from the ambient narrative, which is that we can't do things, we can't do this, we can't do that.
Qu'il n'y a pas de frontière entre le Colorado et le Mexique.
Actually, to question, why isn't there a border between Colorado or Mexico? Well, you don't. It makes sense. You don't need to present yourself as an entity or a community. But when Trump tells you, I'm building a wall on a border that does not exist, then you need to pick a side. You need to pick a side, and that will build a form of collective identity, and that's very much related to conspiracy theories, to all sorts of information that go through our information ecosystem. Very often, there is this side that you have to pick. You need to identify to something. You know, you're one of those who are in the know. And very often, that works with people who tend to be isolated. And they find in these beliefs, in these ideas and visions of the world, they find a common identity. So I think that it is quite important today, if you want to go into politics, to start to understand these phenomena, we need to understand how that fits with conventional politics, because traditional politics, you know, that's obviously cognitive biases. That's what politics is based on. There's nothing else in the end, because politics are based on perception of reality. Reality as such does not matter in the political game, apart from the impact it can have on perception. That's where it's at. So this is all very ancient. There's nothing new under the sun there. Apart from maybe a whole range of tools that we now have to be able to use these cognitive biases in a much more efficient manner. I've spoken a long time. I'm doing your job. I'm not. Don't worry. I will not be speaking this long every time you ask a question.
I'd like to come back to the very beginning of your comments. You were talking about videos on YouTube that mention the Earth being flat. You said these are called attractors. I hope we're not wrong, but I think we all know that the Earth is round. Why is that an attractor? Can we answer that question? Yes, well, counterintuitive news is good. We like that, but if we only get confirmatory information, it's boring. So I think we're all attracted by counterintuitive information, but it has to be moderately counterintuitive. Anthropologists or theologists tell us that a counterintuitive person would can tell us things in that are counterintuitive, and we might fall for it. But something as surprising as the Earth is flat is something that attracts your attention. That's how the press works, and our brain too. And new information that might be important for our survival, especially negative information. There's a negativity bias as well. We're attracted by negative information because they might be more useful than the others. Let me come back to the mechanics of this, Hannes Grassiger. If we click on this video, The Earth is Flat, YouTube and others are going to record this and offer us more of the same. Isn't that a bit devious?
It's very easy to understand platforms, how they work. And there's actually any social media platform consists of three elements. What you get to see on your Facebook, YouTube, Instagram is the result of one, a learning algorithm that selects the pieces of content that it assumes you want to see. Secondly, what is being bought into your time? Like, this is advertisements. This is basically somebody pays and you get to see for it because you're a target group. And thirdly, what you shall not see. This is stuff that gets deleted from your feed by content moderation. This is mostly based on a actual manual of rules. What is not being allowed for on any platform, like terrorism videos or stuff like that. That is like a law book that is constantly being written, and there are thousands and tens of thousands of people working to delete content. And the problem with the cognitive bias that we're currently discussing is basically in the algorithm. And the algorithm is a very complicated thing because it's a machine learning thing that is like a long mathematical formula or a set of actions that is constantly building up and building up and building up, so that even the people who build the original thing don't know how to understand it. So what happens within these companies is that they are constantly battling the outcomes of what this learning algorithm is producing. And that's a very complicated situation. So a Google engineer once described to me, he said, from the outside, Google looks like a shining Boeing, like it's a beautiful new avion. But if you uncover it, then it's like a terrible mess of interacting cables, and nobody knows who built that piece of the algorithm. It feeds data into that element. And so they're constantly trying to deal with the mess. And that was his job description, machine ethicist, trying to understand the unforeseeable outcomes that this thing that they've collectively built produces. And so this is why it's very hard to actually manipulate it, even for themselves. So a very blunt manipulation was when Elon Musk took over Twitter. Some weeks later, it turned out that everybody who opened Twitter would see his face, like his tweets. It was so brute force, they had to get rid of it because people actually saw this was something happening. And they can't make it, come up from time to time. It's very hard. They couldn't figure out some decent way to go against this algorithm, and this is just one of the examples, I think.
You still see a lot of him on Twitter. If you're on Twitter.
Probably you.
You mentioned Elon Musk and his takeover of Twitter. I may be anticipating a debate on the autocracy of the web, if you want to attend that one. But since we're here, these mechanics are complex, but these platforms have owners, so they can be influenced. If we end up with private companies or individuals who have their own ideas of the world and who use technology to foist these ideas on the rest of the world, aren't we going to be in a type of autocracy? So let me put it conversely. Between our cognitive bias, our exposure to information through all this technology, shouldn't we decide that since we're ingurgitating all of this misinformation or just information that's been tailored to us, perhaps citizens aren't able to take the right decisions, and there's no point in carrying on with the democracy. I mean, I'm taking the idea to its logical extension. But please reply briefly, because we want to have some time for questions from the audience. I think there's always been ideology and propaganda. There have always been cognitive biases, but the only difference is now is the new tools we have. I think democracy has to adapt. Before, people read a Catholic newspaper or a communist newspaper, so the bias already existed. It was just more transparent. You got confirmatory bias because you would always buy the same newspaper, because that's what you wanted to hear. But now it's globalized. Things move fast, and these social networks and communities have enabled the minorities to come into the fold, QAnon and the others. You can assemble people around a crazy idea, which you couldn't do before. So democracy is... it's a living being. It's threatened by major interests, but it always has been threatened. It's a challenge for the future. Yes. Anyone else like to tackle this? My opinion is perhaps different from yours. I think the risk is over-policing of the narrative, trying to regulate it. We're trying to stop people from saying things that are completely off the wall. But democracy is freedom of expression and allowing people to have their own ideas. And the idea of content moderation on social networks, this is acceptable, this is unacceptable, this is unacceptable. This, for me, is more of a problem than the people who have crazy theories. Giuliano, but briefly, please. Yes, well, you're right to remind me that we don't have much time. I think that new communication technologies give rise to challenges, and they have done so in the past, as challenges to democracy. When radio was born, at the outset, authoritarian politicians seized the opportunity of the radio. When the Nazis came to power in Germany, Goebbels' ambition was to have a radio in every home. You can imagine the power that that would have. In the United States, the first who got the radio were the populist leaders in Italy. Obviously, Mussolini used the radio. But following that, other democratic leaders managed to use the radio differently. Franklin D. Roosevelt, for example, when he was elected president at the beginning of the 1930s in the U.S., in the midst of a major financial crisis, his policies, the New Deal and all the reforms are known to everyone, but he also invented a new way of communicating using radio, using other media, using a scientific marketing method that was starting to be developed in the U.S. at that time. It was present in companies, and there was a manipulation, there was an element of manipulation to it. But Roosevelt used it for a different purpose. I think that today, what we need is for forces that are not nationalist, populist, or authoritarian, or neo-authoritarian, need to seize these technologies. And I think it's possible. Just very quickly, you say it's possible, but we get the impression that we're still closer to Goebbels than we are to Roosevelt with new technologies today. Have any democratic leaders today managed to use these technologies? Well, look what happened with the wave of the wave of incredible leaders like Bolsonaro, Trump. But it's not just a division between right and left. The five-star movement in Italy, I don't have time to go into that, but it's absolutely fascinating. Etc. These movements, these leaders, fell back. They lost ground. They were beaten in the elections. We've all seen this. But what cropped up in their stead? Not a new generation of political leaders, but rather a return of the old leaders. The wave that was using the engineering of chaos in several ways. And then there was COVID, there were other problems, but what replaced Trump was Biden. The five-star movement in Italy was replaced by Draghi. And now we're seeing another evolution of that in Brazil. Lula is back in power, etc. So these are not people who are using new, innovative, original new media strategies, but these are people who, since these are more traditional leaders, they're not using the media, the new media, but what they're doing is cooling things down. We were reaching meltdown temperatures with the autocratic leaders, but I don't think that is a durable solution. It's just a break. We're seeing a lot of other instruments that are coming up now. Hannes is an expert in all of this. And we're only at the beginning of this, what I call the wave of chaos. Maybe we could give the floor to Hannes quickly.
I think we've just seen the beginning of this technological change of machine learning, things that are adapting and exploiting our biases. And with ChatGPT and all generative AI, we will see a multiplication of such things happening. So the problem for our society, it's actually not if Elon Musk is turning Twitter into a right-wing or left-wing platform. The problem for our society is if we depend on such a platform to use it for us to get informed by it. And so what we must have is a digital informational space that is actually democratically controlled as a place that where we know we get like trustworthy information from, because that will be the problem. And what your engineers of chaos are exploiting is that they can produce information that leads certain people to certain actions or inactions, right? And it's all happening intransparently. We don't understand how to steer it. And thus we need a new set of platforms, just like the BBC was set up, like a public service media for the digital age. This is what we will really need. And so we can let Elon Musk run havoc. Whatever he wants to censor or not, it's up to him. But we need a place where we can get trustworthy information. That's the thing to build, actually, in this era.
Merci beaucoup, comme promis.
Thank you very much. As promised, we're going to take questions from the audience. The microphones are in the hands of the technicians. Well, perhaps we could give yours up. There are too many of us up here on the stage. We don't have enough microphones for the room. Who would like to ask a question? Raise your hand. Don't be shy. Lady in the front row. Does the microphone work? Yes. Thank you. Good evening. Thank you, madam. Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you, Gaëtan. Mr. Da Empoli, I'd like to revert to what you said about the five-star movement in Italy. It's true that the movement has had an incredible history so far. What changes have you seen in the Cinque Stelle? They were born more or less as an internet platform. They won the elections the first time around, and they lost a few feathers. And now it looks like they're making a comeback because Giuseppe Conte, as the leader of the Cinque Stelle, says he's the true leader of the opposition in Madame Meloni's government. How do you see this trend? Has politics caught up with Cinque Stelle, that wanted to be the anti-establishment party? Thank you. A quick reply. Our topic here is not really Italian politics, but your question is relevant. Very dangerous if you get me started on this type of subject, but it might not interest the entire room. So, very quickly, Cinque Stelle is quite a pure example of what I was talking about earlier. A party that bases all of its action on a platform is going to say, well, representative democracy is outdated. We have a new form of direct democracy. We don't really have a platform except to abolish political elites that are all corrupt and represent all of you on the basis of your interests. And that did work because they had attractors, and it's led to, for example, in migration policy, to far-right attitudes and policies. The electors who would have voted on the left, and since this movement was seen also as a left movement, they were using an algorithm, and on the topic of immigration, they got a good portion of the electorate behind them. Then they were cannibalized by Salvini, and today, to a certain extent, by Meloni. I could go on, if you like, but I'm a little bit worried about the time. I probably didn't answer your question, but we can speak about it in private after the session. Yes, you said they use algorithms to push their political ideas, and the whole party follows, and the public follows. Any other questions here in the room? Yes? Short question, please.
Vous êtes bien renseigné, merci.
I see that you're well informed. Can we come back to the film that we've forgotten for all this talk about algorithms? There's a mystery. We see the young journalist. She's a Roma. She's in her village. She hears a news subject saying salaries are on the rise, and she says, well, we know that's not true. Here in the country, we don't even get minimum wage. This means that the Hungarian people are in a very good position to know that television is lying to them. They might be fooled by misinformation about what's happening in Ukraine or on the moon, but not in their village. So how is it that the Hungarian people likes to believe these lies that they themselves are victims of? It reminds me of voluntary servitude, which was a slogan that was used in Russia, about Russia in the 19th century. Sorry that my question was so long. I know I'm a menace. I'm a public menace. No, it's fine. It's fine. It was an excellent question. Who'd like to answer it? Well, you're such a menace that nobody wants to answer. Yes, you're going to take a stab at it?
Well,
I guess I'd say that What seems important and what I think is in a key element in terms of propaganda and misinformation, and this is very closely connected to cognitive bias. I'm trying to keep a thread going here with the topic of the session, but in this case I think it's true. For false information to be effective, it has to speak to people's emotions. It has to have emotional truth. And this is what I think is interesting in communication strategies. When people say they're full of fake news, what we notice is that even if you use a lot of misinformation, fake news, I'm not familiar enough with Hungary to pronounce myself on Orbán, but I think it's probably true in his case as well. The general message has an emotional resonance which rings true concerning the situation that at least a portion of the voters are living in. And this is the paradox of more traditional political parties and political forces that don't use fake news, that are still living in the old world, in the old model, where you started with facts, real information, and put them together. But the overall vision that they're selling sounds fake, even though it's based on real information. That's what the paradox is. And this is where I think that the antidote to this new brand of politics, propagators of fake news, engineers of chaos, cannot be just a technical or technological antidote. We can't, we know that content moderation doesn't really work, as you said, the political dimension is always connected to manipulation and exploitation of technology. This is where you can have regulation, transparency, but we also need the ability to have political discourse that sounds true, that not only is true, but sounds true, and can beat back these fake news, this fake news discourse. So I don't know if I'm making any sense. This is my third panel today. That's what I would say. So one last word from Pascal Wagner again. And then I have one thing to add about, what do you think about emotional truth? I wanted to add something. In social psychology, this is a very old problem. It might not be our topic tonight. Why do people accept huge inequalities? We call it the theory of the justification of the system. People manage to convince themselves that the system is just. So people at the bottom of the social ladder who earn much less think it's because I didn't go to college, etc. And you think, well, you... In all societies, this exists. And it's a broader topic than what we have time for today. Thank you very much for the debate, which I think could continue for some time. In fact, on Wednesday, there's another debate on autocracy of the Internet. Thank you very much to our panelists, and have an excellent evening. And make sure you read the news tomorrow morning.